Good morning. Welcome to worship. Several announcements this morning. The first one is that I got a call from Jim last night, and we're having a few issues with our AC systems. He did go around and turn off several of the systems. If any of you happen to think that you should turn them on, please turn them back off. Something to do with leaky pipes and maybe plugged condensers and frozen coils, stuff like that. So we'll get Cosby out here, but for this morning, it's going to be a little warm, but that's okay. At the end of the month, on the 25th, we have outdoor church at the Gregg Farm, and you will find a sign-up sheet out on the parlor table for food for that. And also out there is the grapevine, and we have a small group meeting today after church. You can check the board for your assignment, or if this happens to be a good day for you, just pop on in. And finally, on my list is the men's breakfast this Saturday, and Susan has announcements for us for the tomato show. Okay, for those who are listening online, basically it's time for tomato show. We have sign-up sheets for supplies and food items that we need, and Susan will be getting with you to check your times for working the booth. Do we have any other announcements this morning? We have a couple of birthdays this week, three of them actually. August is a busy birthday month around here. Joanne Levering has a birthday this week. So does Art Draymond and Barb Taylor Leedy. So if you see them, wish them a happy birthday. Let us stand for the call to worship. Come, let us worship God, for there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God who is above all and through all and in all. Let us worship God. O God of grace and infinite goodness, you nourish us with the bread of life and sustain us with the peace that sets our longing hearts at rest. You fill our cup with kindness. It overflows with the bounty of all your encompassing care. You chose to dwell among us and in us through our Savior Jesus Christ. We praise you and adore you, O God of all. Amen. Our first hymn is number 509, All Who Hunger, Gather Gladly.
Thank you. Good morning. Join me now in the call to confession and the prayer of confession in unison. Let us confess our sin, for we have all fallen short of the glory of God. God, you have called us to live lives worthy of the calling to which we have been called. But we confess to you and each other that we have not always spoken the truth in love, as we have not always made every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the hand of peace. Forgive us, and by your grace, help us to grow in every way into the ways of Jesus. Amen. Whoever comes to Jesus Christ shall never be hungry. Whoever believes in him shall never thirst. Believe the gospel. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, may the reading of your word be for us the bread you send from heaven that gives life to the world. Amen. First scripture reading is Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, cleanse me from my sin, for I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner, when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Our second scripture reading is from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given peace and grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. And when it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all above the heavens, so that he might fulfill all things. The gifts he gave were some that would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knitted together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth and building itself up in love. May God add his blessing to this reading of his word. Now go and grace your neighbor with the peace of Christ.
If you will turn in your hymnals to number 707, we will sing our prayer hymn, Take Thou Our Minds, Dear Lord. Let us now share with one another our joys and our concerns. Of course, we always keep Donnie and Sue in our prayers, and Bob and Ruth as she continues to recover from surgery. Pray for Aunt Alyssa, Jolie's classmate who is going through cancer treatments. My mom's friend Eva has been moved to rehab, but she is still struggling. We're keeping her in our prayers. And for those of you who knew about it last week when Carl and Christine were here, Carl fell down the front steps. But he's sore, but he's okay. And he's doing well. And they are just at his church this morning for a special event that is there. So he's all right. I have a particular joy to share. My nephew and his wife that I had the privilege of joining together in marriage welcomed their son into the world this week, Caleb Benjamin. So, do we have any other joys or concerns that we want to share? Lynn.
Yeah.
Well, and
it's a good thing.
And Lynn, you're here because we need you too. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. God of tears and laughter, you are the giver of life. We pray for your people around the world and within our own borders of country, state, county, and village. We pray for this community, for its churches, its families, its children, and for every individual. Open our eyes to the needs of our neighbors as you equip us to lend aid. We pray for those who are hungry. Bring rain and crops to regions of drought. Provision to those who cannot afford nutritious food. And support to the vulnerable who go without because of the greed of others. Thank you for giving us spirits of generosity. Show us how to help. God, because you are the great physician, we come to you with our concerns. Some we have named, others we carry in our hearts. Bless, soothe, and heal those who need your special care. We pray also for doctors, nurses, aides, first responders, and caregivers. Sustain them in their labors and bless the work of their hands. We pray for comfort and hope for those who mourn the loss of a loved one, whose future stories must be rewritten, and who no longer imagine a joyful future. Heal the void that only you can fill. We pray for your help against all that oppresses. We look forward to the kingdom you have promised and are bringing even now through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our gospel text comes from John chapter 6. But before we read that, let's look back a little bit. Last week we were blessed by the music and the testimonies of Chestnut Ridge, but since I did not have to preach, that also means that we missed the backstory that leads us into our text for today. We join Jesus as he is being approached by a crowd of followers who had been with him the day before. They are part of the crowd of 5,000 men, plus women and children, that had eaten a miraculous meal, not from a midway full of food trucks, but from the sack lunch of a boy that contained 5 small loaves and 2 small fish. They watched as Jesus blessed the loaves and the fish and gave them to his disciples to distribute. They were amazed as everyone ate their fill. And they wondered at the miracle as they counted the baskets of leftovers as they were gathered up. There were 12 of them. Now it is the next morning. Let us turn to the gospel. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? Jesus answered them, Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. Then they said to him, What must we do to perform the works of God? Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Here ends the reading of God's holy word. Have you ever noticed how many people misunderstood Jesus? Never looking past the ordinary to see the extraordinary. Never grasping the spiritual, abstract, and eternal concepts that Jesus came to teach. And this crowd is no exception. Jesus wanted them to be passionate about matters of faith. He wanted them to desire food for the soul, not merely food for the stomach. But they saw only that Jesus could fix their physical hunger and nothing more. Their observations supported their conclusion, and to them, that was that. And so they looked for Jesus in hopes of receiving another jumbo-sized happy meal, except that this time Jesus does something different. When John relates conversations that Jesus has with inquirers, he has a way of following a certain theme. The inquirer says something. Jesus answers by saying something different, something that is hard to understand and seemingly off topic. That saying is then misunderstood by the inquirer, and Jesus answers with saying something that is even more difficult to understand. Following that, there is a discourse and explanation, and John uses this method to bring us through these passages. We watch as men think through things. Sometimes they come to the right conclusion, sometimes they don't. And we are left to think our way through as well. And we have seen this pattern before. When Nicodemus came to Jesus, he said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." To which Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." Nicodemus, you are not searching for a great teacher. You are seeking salvation. When Jesus met the woman at the well, she thought they were discussing the water in the well, until Jesus said, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." Dear woman, you are not looking for H2O. You are longing for redemption. The crowd looked to Jesus for food, and Jesus commanded them, saying, "Don't work for the food which perishes, but for that which lasts forever and gives eternal life." My misguided followers, you cannot fill the void in your life with earthly things. Every attempt to do so will lead to despair. What you seek are the eternal things of God. Jesus' point was that all these Jews were interested in was physical satisfaction. They had received an unexpected free and lavish meal, and they wanted more. But there are other hungers which can be satisfied only by Jesus. There is the hunger for truth. In him alone is the truth of God. There is the hunger for life. In him alone is life more abundant. There is the hunger for love. In him alone is the love that outlasts sin and death. Christ alone can satisfy the hunger of the human heart and soul. Yet, how many times do we seek fulfillment from the vain things of this world? Listen to the story of the stonecutter's folly. There was once a stonecutter who was dissatisfied with himself and his position in life. One day, he passed a wealthy merchant's house. Through the open gateway, he saw many fine possessions and important visitors. How powerful that merchant must be, thought the stonecutter. He became envious and wished that he could be like the merchant. To his great surprise, he suddenly became the merchant, enjoying more luxuries and power than he had ever imagined. But he was envied and detested by those less wealthy than himself. Soon, a high official passed by, carried in a sedan chair. Today we would say he was riding in a limo. Accompanied by attendants and escorted by soldiers beating on gongs. Everyone, no matter how wealthy, had to bow down before the procession. How powerful that official is, he thought. I wish that I could be a high official. Then he became the high official, carried everywhere in his embroidered chair, feared and hated by the people all around. It was a hot summer day, so the official felt very uncomfortable and sticky in his sedan chair, and he looked up at the sun. And it shone proudly in the sky, unaffected by his presence. How powerful is the sun, he thought. I wish that I was the sun. You're catching the pattern now. Then he became the sun, shining fiercely down on everyone, scorching the fields, cursed by the farmers and laborers. But a huge black cloud moved in between him and the earth, so that his light no longer shone on everything below. How powerful is that storm cloud, he thought. I wish I was that cloud. Then he became the cloud, flooding the fields and villages, and was shouted at by everyone. But soon he found that he was being pushed away by some great force and realized that it was the wind. How powerful it is. I wish I was the wind. Then he became the wind, blowing tiles off roofs of houses, uprooting trees, feared and hated by those below him. But after a while, he ran up against something that would not move, no matter how forcefully he blew. It was a huge, towering rock. How powerful that rock is, he thought. I wish I could be a rock. Then he became the rock, more powerful than anything else on earth. But as he stood there, he heard the sound of a hammer pounding a chisel into the hard surface and felt himself being changed. What could be more powerful than I, the rock, he thought. And he looked down and saw far below him the figure of a stonecutter. We do a lot of crazy things trying to fill the void that is in our heart and in our soul. The void that causes a persistent longing for something that we have yet to discover. We are like the crowd looking to fill our emptiness with things that perish. Too often we become so desperate that we'll try anything. And sometimes those things are even things that will harm us rather than fulfill us. Ecclesiastes is a wonderful study on the futility of human pursuits. It begins meaningless, meaningless, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless, said the teacher. Everything is meaningless that is under the sun. And it is. If you place your trust in the transient things of this world, you will be disappointed. Life became meaningless the moment we believed the serpent's lie and became separated from God. But God made a way for us to come home and to have a meaningful life again. Jesus is the solution to a meaningless life. 7 times in the Gospel of John, Jesus says, "I am." I am the bread of life. As bread sustains physical life, so Christ offers and sustains spiritual life. I am the light of the world. To a world lost in darkness, Christ offers himself as a guide. I am the door of the sheep. Jesus protects his followers as shepherds protect their flocks from predators. I am the resurrection and the life. Death is not the final word for those who are in Christ. I am the good shepherd. Jesus is committed to caring and watching over those who are his. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is the source of all truth and knowledge about God. Finally, I am the true vine. By attaching ourselves to Christ, we enable his life to flow in and through us. Then we cannot help but bear fruit that will honor the Father. Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." In other words, the one work that God desires from man and gives to man is faith. It is the basis of all hope and meaning. Jesus spoke to Nicodemus of birth beyond birth. He told the woman at the well about water beyond water. And Jesus told the crowd there is bread beyond bread. These are the paradoxes of faith. What will you choose to fill the empty places of your life? Will it be bread, or will it be the bread of life? Let us pray. Gracious Lord, thank you for Jesus, who is living water and bread of life. Today we choose Jesus and ask you for faith to do so forever. Amen. Out of the bounty of Christ's provision, let us share what has been given to us.
Thank you.
Loving God, bless these gifts that they may be used to feed your people in body, mind, and spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 321, The Church's One Foundation. Trust in the sustaining grace of God as you go forth to love and serve the Lord.